The human mind is very limited, as stated prior in this series. This is because the entire drive in evolution is to survive and pass on genes. Being able to contemplate infinity or even large numbers are not traits required for survival or success in the wild. The average human mind can only grasp the concept of numbers up to 5, 6, or 7, and in some cases as high as 9, at some extremes in areas where primitives do not have numbers. After that point, it just becomes many, and we process it algorithmically. At a certain point, our brain can't even process algorithmically once it becomes too large. I worked on an aircraft carrier in the Navy, and just looking at it hurts your brain to contemplate. Astronauts get vertigo from looking at the Earth from space until their brains can adjust and learn to ignore the fact that it cannot process what it's seeing. So there is little wonder that the human mind really sucks with probabilities, which are nothing but calculations of ginormous numbers. Because of this, people can lie to and prey on uninformed people, using false statistics very easily. Penn and Teller did a show on how easily con artists can trick our brains just by using large numbers, including one where they tried to break a large bill and made it complicated, and the person never even noticed that the con artist walked away $20 richer. Other types of con artists use our limited minds to their advantage as well. These are the religious types. Take prophecy, for example. To a religious person, there seems to be a higher chance that prophecies in the Bible can come true than that it was either a passage taken out of context to fit the prophecy, or that the prophecy was written retroactively to make a better story. When living prophecies occur, people fail to take into account that only the winners of the prophecies and only their correct predictions are the ones that are paid attention to. If you make a ton of predictions, especially about disasters, one of them is statistically going to happen, and because of this, people will flock to the person who happened to make the correct prediction and ignore those who weren't lucky enough to guess correctly about the future. Miracles are exactly the same concept. No one wants to hear about the thousands of tragedies that occur. That's depressing. They just want to hear about the one statistical outlier and believe it to be supernatural. Any person who believes in the book of Revelation will tell you that the end times are very near, because the Bible says that there will be more wars, people calling for peace, and more natural disasters. They fail to realize the number of wars have actually dropped, and the number of natural disasters have remained the same, except for the ones linked to climate change. However, due to our explosion in communication and media, and the fact that the American news media knows that disaster news sells like hotcakes, we are now constantly being told about disasters that occur, things that we would have been previously oblivious to. Creationism uses our limited perception of probabilities when they use the argument against abiogenesis and evolution by natural selection as being as probable as a Boeing 747 being made by a tornado. They fail to realize that this mathematician himself, who stated this, said that the statistics were quite probable over a very slow gradual change, which is exactly what abiogenesis and evolution does. Watch my very first series called The Case Against Intelligent Design for a breakdown of probabilities. Probabilities, statistics, and chaos theory were the very last linchpin that kept me from accepting evolution and in turn rejecting religion. I remember my dad telling me that statistics were stupid and the majority of people tend to have a distrust of this field, especially in terms of surveys. Unless it goes in their favor, or a tiny fact-mind piece of it goes in their favor, and then they quote it as gospel. Just this morning, I heard a Republican senator cite a poll showing that the majority of Americans dislike the health care bill. He tried to make it sound as if the majority of Americans agreed with the Republicans. If you stop there, your perception would make it appear that he was right. NPR, however, looked at the survey and found that there were other questions asked on it, and the majority of Americans supported health care reform, but the majority of Americans had problems with certain portions of the bill and agreed with it overall. The poll also found that the majority of Americans wanted Obama to be more forceful with Republicans in passing the bill through, and that majority of Americans distrusted Republicans by 10% more than they distrusted Democrats. It's amazing how you can use any poll or statistic to your advantage if you omit most of it. Science-based polls require multiple questions asked from multiple angles and varying levels of detail, or they will get confirmation bias or inaccurate data. While people distrust big odds when it goes against their beliefs or ideas, they have no problem with taking huge and foolhardy risks where the odds are completely against them. We have a naturally evolved trait linked to our reward pathway system to gamble and take risks. In the case of casinos, the possibility of a big reward can blind them to the ridiculously staggering odds of losing. This is why Christians jump at Pascal's wager so easily and don't even take into account that another religion has equal probability of being right as their own, given the evidence they fail to have. Risk-taking is a trait that is inherent to us as humans. This is because if risk pans out, the winner takes all, and that has for millennia meant mates as well, especially in hunter-gatherer societies. In Jared Diamond's book, Why Sex is Fun, he discussed a tribe of people who had little to no contact with the outside world. In their societies, women pound sago, which is a boring but steady job, no risk involved, while the men basically live on hunting parties, killing small game, which they will eat among themselves and not share with the women and children. About once a month, they will be able to bring down big game and take it back and share it with a tribe. The purpose is not, however, for altruistic reasons. The purpose is to barter for infidelity with many of the women of the tribe. Men could easily pound sago too, and if you look at the actual amount of food men and women each bring in, women bring in way more because they have a steady and progressive way of doing things. However, it is the perception of all that food at once that allows this sort of risk to continue. Being hailed brave and a hero, as well as a risk taker, is something that women are primed to find attractive. Throughout history, warriors have received the same status by genetic psychology of women. The reason for this is that the risk taker that wins has a lot more goods to care for their mate and children and tends to pass on a lot more genes with more women than a man that does not take risks, many times with a non-risk taker's mate. Just because a man has more goods, however, does not mean that he will be a good father, and it is many times a quantity over quality strategy in evolution. However, just because you're a risk taker does not mean you will win. Natural selection only allows risk takers who succeed to pass on their genes. Many of the risk takers fail and die, or in the modern market, fail financially. But in the modern market, they tend to be capable still of passing on their genes because they aren't removed from the gene pool via natural selection anymore. They also have an added bonus for passing on genes in this safe world, as women are still wired to be attracted to the bad boy. Women don't really want to date a guy who is abusive or takes stupid risks in their mind, but hormonally, the traits a risk taker exhibits makes a lot of women weak-kneed. These women then can't figure out why they can't find any good men when there are great non-risk takers, but they don't give nearly the same drug rush as a bad boy does. This is why so many nice guys finish last until they reach their 30s or 40s, when women have learned to distrust their hormones by that time. The only way to make a good assessment of probabilities is through the meticulously proven study which we call math. Emotions can make any probability seem either too probable or impossible, depending on which way our emotional and personal interests lie. Confirmation bias is our bane, without the mental construct of math, because huge numbers mean nothing to our limited brains.